Condé Nast Entertainment, who produced it, called me and pitched me an idea that wasn't right at all for Amazon. And I said, that's not right at all for Amazon. But what about something with The New Yorker? I'd been a subscriber for 15 years, 20 years at that point. And they said, that's funny, we've been talking to Alex Gibney about that. And I said, I'm also a fan of Alex Gibney, that sounds great. And it was pretty seamless. Within a month or so of that, we were doing the show. It was still early on. I mean, Amazon has only been around Amazon Studios TV for about 4 years. And it was pretty frictionless, and you know, soon we were making the show.
And so you were making the show, and Kahane Cooperman comes in. How did you get involved in this? And then, how did you do this?
So, for me, I had been at The Daily Show with Jon Stewart for 18 years. I was there almost the entire time. And but starting on day one, but my background was documentary, filmmaking, and storytelling, which is how I got hired there in the first place. And it was obviously an amazing experience to be part of that institution, but I always missed that other part of me, that those muscles just couldn't really be exercised there. And so I tried to do, whenever possible, keep that part of me nurtured in a way. So I kept a foot in the door, and in doing that, I actually met Alex Gibney a couple times, briefly, but I guess, you know, my impact was enough that that the day after Jon Stewart announced on the air that he was leaving The Daily Show, Alex Gibney got in touch with me the next day. And so I had known that whenever my next chapter started, I wanted to go back to that, to storytelling, documentary filmmaking, and I didn't know when that chapter would start, and I never dreamed it would start when it did. It started with him, and then next up was Joe.
She was very good. What's your biggest weakness?
I snuck into one of the green rooms at The Daily Show with my computer, and it was my first ever Skype call, by the way, because he was in Los Angeles and I was in New York, and I had to I'm terribly, terrible technically. And so I made it work, and I remember you were very interested in risk-taking, and that's one of the things I appreciate working with Amazon, is that the whole time, like, the directive from the network, which is unusual, is take risks. We want things that are provocative and that get people talking, and so that's just been a very exciting note to have all the way through.
So your title is, excuse me, showrunner, which I just learned the other day, basically means you are the person who oversees everything. These two episodes that we just saw, you were involved in each one of the pieces that we saw. When we were talking earlier, you said that you, DJed these episodes. Talk about that.
Well, I think what I have learned is an unusual idea, which was not to create any of the episodes ahead of time. I wanted to create all the films first, see what they were, see how they came out, see how they made you feel, and then from that, create the episodes. So when I say DJ, it's because I felt like what I could do with all of these films was to sort of create an experience in the same way that a DJ controls the mood of a room by playing a fast song and then a slow song. You're really manipulating, in a way, the emotions of the people in that room, and I felt like there was a possibility of doing that with these episodes and these pieces that really run the gamut. And, you know, by the way, like, these two episodes, that's like some of the types of pieces that we have in the series. It's by no means representative of everything.
There's
10 episodes, and some are full of whimsy, and you know, it runs the gamut, like The New Yorker. I mean, there's just everything. So
Joe,
that's how.
Like you wanna... No, I was just thinking that DJ just minimized her contribution. I would call her CEO of the show. Sounds more accurate. She's getting a lot of people to
boss.
Work. Boss.
I mean, what a showrunner does is I had to build a machine that could produce more than 50 films at a very high quality, because we're living up to the standards of this incredible magazine, The New Yorker, in a very short period of time, with a lot of people weighing in on them, while respecting the filmmakers' visions and also respecting The New Yorker, and the writer's intentions with these, all of these articles and essays and short stories and comedy, shouts and murmurs, humor.
Talk about this, what we just saw in this documentary, and how it fits in with what you know. Does it fill in any blanks? Does it amplify things that you already knew, maybe things that we didn't already know?
Well, yeah, I mean, in some ways, what I wondered is whether the audience finds it as much more powerful because it's, you see these faces that we as writers get to see. So I've interviewed Ali Soufan, and I've seen that anger in his face, and Mark Rossini, who, and when you sit down with these people, and you're not even sure you're going to get them to be able to go on the record at all in the beginning, and they, you can just see there's the disgust and anger that they feel that maybe the U.S. could have avoided those 9/11 attacks. I think it's kind of incredible for an audience to finally get to see it. We try to convey it in words, but I think it's in some ways more powerful to see it on the screen so you get to see their faces talking.
Who is Michelle?
Her name is classified. But I wonder if this film won't, in some ways, if it gets much public currency, launch a movement of people out, just ordinary Americans, saying, we'd like some accountability, please. We'd like to know who Michelle is. We'd like to know who Michelle's supervisor is. And we'd like to know why they let this fall through the cracks. Because they have still not answered the questions properly over in the agency. They do have a couple different versions of answers, and I've gotten some of them in the book that I wrote called The Dark Side. I was told that the report that was written about these two Al-Qaeda members who had come to the U.S. was stuck in a sort of a bureaucratic mistake in somebody's outbox and never shared. Yet it was very strange because the person who didn't share it told everybody else that she had shared it with the FBI. So what gives? I think, you know, after Pearl Harbor, there were really detailed investigations that happened right away that explained what went wrong, and the country learned from the mistakes. Instead, what happened in this situation, I think in some ways, is because of the mystery that surrounds this. The CIA has been able to spin a different narrative, which suggests we needed to go to tougher kinds of ways of dealing with terrorists, such as waterboarding. But what if, in fact, it was just a bureaucratic snafu or just a turf war that made us miss it and had nothing to do with torturing people? I kind of think I'm interested to see if this will launch people's curiosity.
The interesting part of when you're reading The New Yorker is that you're such an active participant in the story itself. You know, the nature of reading as a whole, and I think the nature of TV as a whole is, you know, you're more leaning back. And I do think there's, I don't think this world could ever possibly replace The New Yorker, but it's so utterly and unbelievably complementary to it. I think that's the real nature of seeing a story that you're reading, and you're in control of the pace, and your imagination fills in a lot of those details. And that's what I love when you're seeing people testify before Congress, or seeing people, the actual experience of it on their faces. There's no limit to like what you, the amount of information you're taking in. I just think that's, you know, the power of this, and to be able to see it is super exciting to be a part of. And
I have to say, as someone at the magazine also who writes very sort of, you know, nonfiction kinds of reported stories, investigative stories, I loved seeing something like the Jacob Lawrence essay brought to life. I think it was beautiful and powerful, and at a time when news coverage is often just sound bites and not very complex or intellectually stimulating, and the arts don't, maybe serious arts don't get that much play on the regular news, I thought it was wonderful to see that.
I should mention that Jane is the author of Dark Money.
A new book. It's so, all the darks.
Number 6 on Amazon.
And number 2 on New York Times Nonfiction.
And we'll ship it to you free if you have Prime. It's a great deal.